Professor Philippe Descola, I'd like to begin the interview by thanking you on behalf of everyone at the Anthropology Department for being here with us in Helsinki and for the chance to ask you some questions about your work. And the questions will try to cover the phases of your career in broad strokes and also try to situate your thought in relation to some of the main trends and issues in our discipline. Your early studies were in philosophy, but you decided to pursue anthropology and did fieldwork in the mid-1970s for 3 years with the Achuar of the Upper Amazon, hoping to learn about how their society relates to the surrounding nature. What ignited your interest in anthropology and compelled you to embark on that project?
Well, there's a long tradition in France of social scientists converting from philosophy to the social sciences. It started early on, Durkheim, Lévi-Brun, Lévi-Strauss, and a long list of other names, and more recently Bourdieu, Cotelier, and other people went through this metamorphosis. One of the reasons, probably, and the one that is that I felt strongly, and that most of my friends who went through the same conversion experience, was the fact that philosophy was asking questions about. Especially, one has to take into account that it is a certain variety of philosophy, which is not French philosophy in itself, but it's a way of teaching philosophy in France, which in fact is based on the history of discursive formations. So it is a very good training to allow you to understand how concepts are in interplay with other concepts in a specific text, how text from one philosopher respond to text to another philosopher, etc. So it's more a philosophy oriented towards the history of philosophy, the critical history of philosophy. And as such, it's a very good training. But I felt dissatisfied by the fact that the questions that were being asked were the questions that had been asked ever since 2,500 years ago from the Greeks onwards about the being, truth, about the legitimacy of certain kind of scientific propositions, about morality, etc., etc., without absolutely taking into account other ways of asking these questions that could be observed, that had been observed by anthropologists elsewhere, by historians also. So there was a self-centered dimension to philosophy, which I found problematic. And this is why, rather than being interested in experiment of thought, I like many others again in France, preferred to be interested or to study or to be acquainted with experiments, real life experiments, how people did in their lives, in the way they organized their lives, those questions that were not conceivable in the philosophical panorama in general. So the result was that I was, again, as many French anthropologists and social scientists, familiar with the great names of philosophy, familiar with the analysis, the critical analysis of discourse. and that I decided, I'd been interested in anthropology in general very early on. I'd read Triste Tropique when I was 16 or 17, and I was fascinated not so much by the, not so much the Indians in the book, because it's an intellectual biography, but I was fascinated by the man, by Lévi-Strauss, by someone who was at the same time, obviously, a very learned and sensible person who wrote very well, with a very incisive mind, who could write as well on Debussy and Rousseau and on the Bororo Indians in Brazil. So this a form of humanism, you know, of very broad culture, fascinated me in the person. I said, if this person is an anthropologist, then anthropology must be a fascinating science also. And this is how I decided to read a little bit more in anthropology, in particular, but because I went through the classical French system of competitive examination, which is very much like the Chinese, the Mandarin system. No, so I went to the Economie Supérieure, and all my disciples were precisely were either in literature and philosophy or even in math or physics, because it's an integrated school, and they were discussing the more philosophical texts of Lévi-Strauss or of anthropology. So they were discussing the savage mind or the Triste Tropique. I was also interested in the elementary structure of kinship and things like that, which were more technical. So, so progressively I moved towards anthropology, and then there was a former student of the Economie Supérieure, Maurice Godelier, who had just published, he was young at the time, and he was just back from his fieldwork with the Baruya in New Guinea. And he had just published a book which was called Rationality and Irrationality in Economy, which was a book of, broadly speaking, criticism of political economy, and a new reading of the capital, which was a very common thing, Marx's capital, which was a very common thing at the time. Now we were immersed in the texts of Marx and Engels, and especially Marx. And so, in his book, at the end, there's an analysis of pre-capitalist forms of production and exchange, which I found fascinating. And I think here was a rigorous way to enter the question of the diversity of the forms of life, let's say, in the world. So that's when I decided to become an anthropologist. And the reason I went to, I first went to Mexico, to southern Mexico, for my first fieldwork. I was, as we all were at the time, when I mean all our, many of the students in philosophy in particular, in my generation, we were all militant. So I was a militant of the, I was a Trotskyite, and so I thought that by going in the cauldron of neocolonialism to try to understand the local situation, I would be faithful to my political leanings. So I went to southern Chiapas, to a place where in the forest, in the Lacandon forest, where Tzeltal colonists, that is Indians from the Maya Indians from the highlands, had moved to settle the forest because they had been pushed away from their lands by landowners. And I was interested already in the way that people adapt to new environmental circumstances. Mm-hmm. The problem was they did not adapt very well, in the sense that they felt rather unhappy. It was a very different form of environment. Although it was only a 6-7 days walk from the highlands, it was really deep forest. And so I spent a few months there, and then I felt dispirited because they were themselves quite unhappy. And I said, I can't spend 2 years with people who are not really happy in the forest. I think it's important that when you do fieldwork, you should at least be happy yourself. Happy, I don't know what happiness means in that case, but you should feel well, no?
Yes.
Otherwise, if it's considered, if fieldwork is a sort of duty, I don't think it's good fieldwork. You can't do good fieldwork if you every morning you say, I must get up and do my work, etc., etc. You must enter into the flow of things, I think, in order to do good fieldwork. So in that case, it didn't go well, and in fact, these people became the forerunners of the Zapatista movement afterwards. No, so there were good reasons not to be happy. No?
Sure.
The landowners were also moving in the forest, etc. So I decided. So I thought going to the Amazonia. I had thought about it, but I thought it was very petit bourgeois to go to the Amazonia, no, romantic and so on. So, but I decided what to hell with my scruples.
Okay.
So I decided to go to Amazonia. Amazonia for a variety of reasons. One of them was that it was we had no real understanding what Amazonia was, what Amazonian people were. And, you know, there was, of course, there was Lévi-Strauss and a few good ethnographers. There were Stephen and Christine Hugh Jones, who had just come back from their field. That's what we were talking about, the beginning of the 70s, mm-hmm. 73. I think the first time I went to the Amazon, I went to Mexico in 73, and I went to the Amazon in 74, to Ecuador. And at the time, there was only there were very few things. So, I mean, some of the things that Lévi-Strauss had written on mythology, there were people like Mabel Lewis who had written on the Aquashavante, a very classical monograph of the British sociological school, let's say. There was Goldman on the Cubeo. There were a few books, but there was not a tradition in anthropology on the lowlands. One of the things which struck me when reading this scattered literature, which in fact began, that's the interesting aspect also, by contrast with other parts of the world, the ethnographic literature in Amazonia begins very early on, in the 16th century,
mm-hmm.
before ethnography or anthropology become real sciences. And there is a sort of leitmotif in this ethnography, on these first descriptions, which goes until now, in fact, which is that these people are mysterious, enigmatic, in the sense that they don't show any kind of institution that could be likened to the institutions we are used to. No, there's no, in French, the French chroniclers who settled, who visited, and some of them settled on the coast of Brazil in the 16th century, wrote that these people were sans foi, sans loi, sans roi, without faith, king, or law. And so they did not exhibit any of the normal institutions. There was no territory to speak of, at least they were and there were no villages in many cases. People who lived in scattered habitats. There were no chiefs. There were no cult. few rituals. These rituals were all linked to war, etc., etc. People were, Europeans were very puzzled by this. And what they all emphasized was that these people were naturals. They were in fact, in a way, glued to nature. Yeah. They were either positively, in the sense that they were, in fact, that is Montaigne, the version that Montaigne developed, for instance, the naked philosophers. No, all they were brutes, intent on killing each other, and incapable of controlling their natural instincts. No? Mm-hmm. So there was a leitmotif there. So mm-hmm. I was reading these chronicles, and then the proto-ethnography, and then the later ethnography. I was struck by this, and I said there must be something in their relation to nature, which is very specific for this leitmotif to go on for centuries. Right. And at the time, there was the main type of publications in anthropology on Amazonia in the United States, that wasn't the case in England or in France or in Brazil, were belonged to the so-called cultural ecology or material ecology school, which were extremely reductionist and also interpreted all social features and cultural features as a product of adaptation to nature. Mm-hmm. So there was a continuity in that sense. Mm-hmm. And so I left for fieldwork with the idea of precisely studying in depth how these people related to what I still called at the time nature.
Right.
Okay. And so that's how I went to Ecuador with my wife and Christine Taylor.
Okay. It leads quite nicely to
finish. Can I take up there because
I'll just keep track of the time. Oh, this leads quite nicely onto the next question. You've said that your central anthropological interests, in addition to everything you've just recounted, also arose from the astonishment you felt when you encountered some of the Achuar ways of doing things. Why is astonishment important for ethnography, and how do the encounters and stories of your time with the Achuar continue to inform your work?
I think astonishment is absolutely crucial. It's ever since Plato, it's considered to be an important quality for philosophers, no? Mm-hmm. The fact never to take anything for granted and being astonished by things, no? So going further by not, again, taking anything as evidence. And I think it is also for anthropologists. And this is why going to places which are, and to live among people who are very different from the one you've been brought up with, is important. It's not, of course, a question of primitivism, of essentialism, whatever the name you choose to give to that. Mm-hmm. It's a question of using the distance as a lever to pry open the concepts that would otherwise appear matter of fact or self-evident.
Yes.
And so the distance, the distance or the epistemological distance, if you wish, is always created, of course. But if there is effectively a cultural distance, a geographical distance, but maybe a cultural distance, maybe not going very far away, it helps destabilizing one's own assumptions.
Yes.
No? And this is why Amazonia was very interesting in that display, because it was perhaps the farthest one could go in terms of differences, you know, because nothing, again, there was a sort of logical scandal in these people. Now, where was society there? No, where was, especially among the Achuar? Again, very completely scattered habitat. People were feuding between themselves. There was no chief. I'd read before. In fact, a very, very interesting description by a missionary. At the end of a Dominican missionary at the end of the 19th century, who had been going on the outskirts of the Achuar thing, they have no religion except bird songs and dreams, and that was very, very, very clever, no, to understand because in fact, yes, dreams are important because they are one of the means of communication with the world of spirits, of non-humans, the spiritual dimension of non-humans, and bird songs are these songs that the Achuar and the Hiro in general sing constantly, right, in order to connect themselves precisely with. So he had the clear idea that in fact their religion was that, no. But this lucidity was not very common at the time, and so this is why the Achuar were fascinating in that respect.
Yeah. Is there a particular encounter or story that's very memorable, even if it were a brief one, that would illuminate for you in your personal experience some of this?
Well, I think I mentioned it I've written extensively on the Achuar, but I've mentioned a specific episode in the Beyond Nature and Culture at the beginning of the book, if I remember correctly, which is a story where I'm discussing we are in a house and the lady of the house is being she goes to dump the garbage of the house. She's been sweeping the house, dump the garbage by the river, and she's bitten by a snake. It's a very dangerous snake, and so she's terrified, and then everybody in the house begins wailing, she's going to die, so it doesn't that much. So I had serum, I had lyophilized serum, so I gave her an injection, and then the husband was completely devastated, and I was trying to speak with him and to lift up his spirits, and he said, "It's my fault. In fact, it's my fault because it's a revenge of the master of animals, because yesterday I went to the forest. I had a new shotgun. He used to hunt before with his blowgun only, and so he had acquired a shotgun to exchange with another Achuar, and he killed. There was a troop of woolly monkeys, and he killed many more than he would have needed to kill, which is a very classical story among hunters, you know, everywhere in the world. So his hubris made him responsible for the revenge that took the form of a snake bite on his wife. No, so this, and so talking with him, no, it's I realized how important it was. No, so and there are a number of stories like that. No, it's, you know, when you do field work and it takes a long time to learn the language. It took us about a year. And so progressively you understand bits and pieces. There was only one young man who knew a little bit of Spanish, not much. So that was, we really started. They were very forthcoming, and the first place where we landed, no, people accepted us quite willingly. I suspect because we were a distraction, no? They actually, we were like pet. They have pet pet animals everywhere in the houses, so we added to the collection of pets. Now they're observing us, and my wife and I, and was a day-to-day distraction. So I suspect one of the reasons for this, the way they received us, was this. And after a while, we just became part of the daily life. And so learning the language progressively is like watching a movie in a language you don't understand, and then you have subtitles that begin to appear, but they are disconnected, etc. So you get bits and pieces. And when you really start understanding and things, this is when precisely you realize these dimensions. So the first few months I did one of the things I intended to do, so I did a very thorough study of the way they were using plants and animals. So things which could be defined as economic anthropology or human ecology, etc., etc. So I collected plants and a specimen of soil, etc., etc. No? Mm-hmm. So I wasn't idle in that sense. No, at mm-hmm. the time where, and progressively I came out of this gathering of technical and quantified material very often mm-hmm. to understanding what they were saying about the thing I had been measuring. No, mm-hmm. and obviously there was a huge void between what I was considering at the time, the way these people were adapting to their environment, and in fact the way they thought about it, you know, which was in fact a series of interaction with non-humans treated as social partners.
Yes.
And so that's when I came to realize that it was absurd to think in terms of a society adapting to a natural environment, mm-hmm. nature, society, where useless concepts for that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So this is what informed your first monograph in the Society of Nature. You were bridging the gap between ecological and symbolic approaches in anthropology. Mm-hmm. You focused on praxis, and you tried to demonstrate in that book the ways the various material demands and cultural ideas that shape Achuar interactions with non-humans are in actuality very interwoven mm-hmm. processes. So you already said quite a bit about what was novel or unique, but can you say a little bit more about that in connection to how your approach was informed by Marx and mm-hmm. Levi-Strauss's mm-hmm. work?
In fact, I was not the only one. Anthropologists and many students in anthropology were, or not only anthropology, in the social sciences, where there were three important threads that we were trying to weave together. One was Marxism, which was very important for us. The other was structuralism, and the third was phenomenology. Mm-hmm. As students in philosophy, we had read a lot of Husserl, and of course afterwards Merleau-Ponty and Heidegger, of course. And so the question was, how do you combine or weave together these obviously incompatible traditions? And so Godelier was an interesting case, for instance, of trying to produce structural Marxism, no? I felt dissatisfied. Everything I did was because I felt dissatisfied on the one hand with the materialist perspective, which was where there would be a material basis and then a series of layers, like a layer cake, no? And then the political system and the ideological system, etc. And then afterwards, when you've put all your layers, you spend your life trying to understand how this different layers communicate. And of course, you can't, because you've started by dividing them so and disconnect the them. The other dimension, which was not necessarily Lévi-Strauss, but some of his epigodes or students were doing, which was, in fact, treating nature as a purely intellectual problem. That is the study of classifications, for instance, of folk classifications. He does that very well in La Pensée Sauvage, for instance. So nature is a sort of catalogue of properties which the mind uses in order to construct interesting and complex combinations in myth, in classification, etc. But there was more, of course, than this intellectual problem, in the sense that the Achuar were not concerned with nature as an intellectual problem. They were concerned with nature, with non-humans on a day-to-day basis. Mm-hmm. So they were social partners. Nature was not only good to think, it was good to interact with.
Yes.
And that's the thing which became absolutely obvious for me. No? It's good to interact with. So how do you interact with non-humans? How do you interact? You can't interact with nature because it's an hypostasis. No, it's like interacting with the state. It's a fiction, no? You interact with representative of a state or representative of nature. So the best is to eliminate nature altogether and to see how people interact with non-humans. And in fact, I did that when I came back after my doctoral dissertation, which was published in English under the title "In the Society of Nature." I started teaching at the École des Hautes Études. I was fortunate enough to get a position soon after I finished my doctoral thesis, and I started a seminar. And in fact, I was ravenous, no, trying to understand with ethnography from neighboring societies, that is from Amazonia, and then progressively with other parts of ethnography, other parts of the world, how the kind of analysis had given of the Achuar would be. Not applicable, but how I could have an idea of how people interacted with non-humans.
Yes.
Elsewhere. And so I discovered that in Amazonia, most of the features I described among the Achuar was all present. No, there was a very common ground there. So the fact that game animals were all considered as affines. Mm-hmm. That was all over the place.
As persons.
Persons, not only as persons, mm-hmm. but as affines also.
So as proximals, as friends or associates, but not family necessarily.
Well, affine is affinity is a complex relationship in general, and especially in Amazonia, no?
Yes.
And so affinity is a good relationship to to qualify this, because as this, and this is one I will talk about that later, but this is one I began to meet Eduardo Villarroel de Castro, mm-hmm. that we had all these discussions about. He took affinity from the point of view of the relationship with humans, while I was interested in affinity as the relationship with non-humans, and we discovered that it was a continuity. We arrived to affinity from different perspectives, from different interests. No, mm-hmm. he came to affinity when studying the cannibalism and in general the Tupian mm-hmm. attitudes toward affinity, in-laws, etc. Mm-hmm. I came to that by studying the relationship with the game animals, and we discovered it was the same real. Of social of relations in terms of social if you wish to call them social relations in general. So during this process, the seminar was very good. For that, because it was a research seminar, and I was systematically discussing with the students these materials, first from Amazonia and then from northern North America. So I progressed northward and then westward to Siberia, etc. Mm-hmm. I discovered also that in Siberia the main relationship with the game animals was a relationship of affinity. Mm-hmm. It wasn't presented like that. It's potentials. They are potential spouses, etc., etc. So that's when the idea of animism began. No, so there's something there which is not linked to. It's not because they are hunters gatherers, because they are not hunter gatherers. No, in Amazonia, the main cultigens have been domesticated at least 8,000 years ago. So they have a long tradition of dealing, manipulating plants, etc. It's not a question of. It's a specific outlook towards non-humans that you find in different places of the world. Mm-hmm. And this is when I decided to revive this old concept of animism, which had fallen into disrepute, yes. To define the fact of treating non-humans as humans, using the same categories that were used to treat humans. So, because of course, what I found with the Achuar and elsewhere was not only that the game animals were considered treated as affines, but that the plants, in particular, in very often, especially of course among the Achuar, but very often also when they were cultivated, plants were treated as concert wines. So the two main categories with which in Dravidian kinship systems, people are organized, which are consanguines and affines, were used also to deal with non-humans. That was my first theory of animism, if you wish, no?
Right, yeah.
Which was in fact, which afterwards, with a lot of discussions with colleagues, precisely that people the Castro, and with I've had over the years what I like to call sparring partners, no? Yes. So they're Vivios de Castro, the Tim Ingold, Bruno Latour, they are both friends and sparring partners in the sense that we can discuss freely. We agree to disagree, no? Yeah. So we have a good enough basis of agreement in order to be able to disagree. And this is when I realized that my definition of animism was a bit too Durkheimian, no? Because I contrasted it with totemism in the Lévi-Straussian sense, no? That is, totemism, the use of natural categories in order to understand to conceptualize social categories, no?
Yes.
The transposing and the differences between species to differences between human groups. Yes. So I'd use this definition of totemism to contrast with animism, in the sense of animism was using, on the contrary, almost the reverse, no? That is, using natural categories, or social categories rather, in order to deal with non-humans. And then I realized that I was a bit Durkheimian, so we had of discussions with Philippe Descola in this respect, and on totemism with Tim Ingle, who said that the historical definition of totemism was much too classificatory and intellectual in a sense. So I started reading also material on Australia, mm-hmm. and I became aware that yes, in fact, it was much too classificatory. Mm-hmm. And this is when, after a while and some years, I came rather to this, to the combinatorial matrix that I put forth in Beyond Nature and Culture,
yes.
Where in fact the relationship between what I call animism, totemism, naturalism, which is our in bracket,
yes.
way of doing things ever since the, well, 17th century, if you wish to give a specific date, and what I called analogism, mm-hmm. where all transformations of each other as and a transformation of an initial contrast between, on the one hand, interiority and physicality, mm-hmm. and on the other hand, difference and resemblance. No?
Right.
So which provided a sort of initial matrix,
yes.
to differentiate ways of detecting continuities and discontinuities between humans and non-humans.
Yes. And so in this book, you, in Beyond Nature and Culture, you bring a vast amount of ethnography. And you apply this combinatorial matrix to describe the kinds of collectives that these four basic ontologies make possible. How did you intend this book to be taken up by anthropologists, for example, in political ecology work? And how would you sum up the central message of that book for a wider audience of people?
I don't know if I intended, you know, when you write a book like that, it's although I had these pairing partners, one of them being, of course, my wife and Christine Taylor, but in spite of the sparring partners, you pursue a solitary path, no? So I had no idea at all what would be the reception of the book. So I was very surprised when I saw that it triggered a lot of interest in many quarters. I don't know if it's been translated recently only, in fact, in English, so it's been available for 3 years, but in French it's been published in more than 10 years ago. Wow. And so you can, it's a good enough, long enough period to see the results. And so it has had an important effect among philosophers, yeah. architects, artists, a number of people, geographers, mm-hmm. Not necessarily for what I intended to do, for a variety of reasons. Each reader taking in it something which he found interesting or relevant,
yeah.
to the discussion in his or own discipline.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm entirely convinced of this thing, which is nothing original, that once you write a book, it escapes you entirely.
Yeah.
And of course, it's being read and commented, interpreted by other people. And in some cases, I think it's Valéry who said that, it's almost a century ago. it may be that even the interpretation that the a reader gives may be more interesting than the one you give yourself, of your own writing, not of the facts, of your own writing. So you do not own a copyright, in fact, on the ideas. They are just scattered in the wide world, and people use them for what. So there's no, it's absurd to maintain any orthodoxy of a doctrinal orthodoxy. People use it as, and I'm observing with interest what people are doing with it. Especially, in fact, if I did that, it's because, if I did this book, it's because I was interested in providing tools which would allow people to go beyond the classical distinctions on which the social sciences have been based ever since the Enlightenment. If it's what I did is has been at times defined as being part of the so-called ontological turn, and if there is an ontological turn in what if I'm part of this ontological turn, it is because I think that the I feel it's necessary to go to an analytical level which is beyond the classical concept that have been used, like society, history, nature, transcendence, etc., that we've been using as matter of fact, in the social sciences ever since they existed, that is the 19th century. And what if we must go beyond it is at the level where people precisely detect continuities and discontinuities in the world. So it's a very elementary level, and the kind of systematization that they will do according to the social setting where they've been brought up as to these continuities and discontinuities seems to me to fall within one of these four formula, which are. But these are models, no? They are not. They do not describe. I think you may, at one time you said the describing collect. I'm not describing anything. I'm providing models, with which you try to understand what are the rules governing compatibilities and incompatibilities between features, no?
Yes.
So it's not a description, it's not intended as a descriptive tool, it's intended as an analytical device in order to understand what are the conditions for bringing together in what I call collectives certain features and excluding other features. So it and it's a heuristic in that sense. No, it's not a descriptive model. It's a heuristic, and so what? For instance, when I speak of collectives, borrowing the word from Bruno Latour, although with a different sense than the one he gave to it, it's because I'm interested in the form of aggregates that exist. All over the world, with humans and non-humans, we are one of the aggregates. I mean, we naturalists, in the sense that we, and this is, in a way, I disagree with Latour on that. I think we decided that there was. There were beings that were natural and other beings which were humans, and this was the very important dividing line with a lot of consequences. And these dividing lines resulted in the fact that we deal with societies, societies are societies of humans. You don't speak. You can speak in ethology at times of with social species, for instance. Mm-hmm. But the great obsession of ethologists precisely is not to bring sociological concepts or projecting sociological concepts on the animal, the non-human animal species they are studying. So we have excluded in our collectives non-humans. Others have brought them into their collective, but in very different fashions. Or they thought of collectives, or the animists, for instance, see, as I understand it, all forms of life as, well, not even of life, all morphological morphologically distinguished beings who are active in a way as constituting a tribe in a way, a tribe species, you know, as I call them, who are in interaction with each other. So it's as many collectives as there are morphologically distinct forms of being. Right? Mm-hmm. And I always quote this description by Bogohas of the Chukchi, when he said, for the Chukchi, the shadows on the wall live in their own villages where they subsist by hunting. Yeah. What does this mean? Of course they're not idiots. They understand that the shadows on the wall are made by the interposition of a body mm-hmm. with a source of light. Mm-hmm. But this is a specific form of being, which is a shadow, and as any other form of being, mm-hmm. it has its autonomy, it has its social rules, it has its culture, etc., etc., etc. So when you're talking of collective, you're not presupposing that society as we understand it is the basis, the central concept of analysis mm-hmm. that we're giving ourselves. It's just a form of aggregate, and what we have to study and understand is how people constitute these aggregates. And this is repeatable for every other concept, no? The subject, for instance, what is a subject? The subject is not necessarily derived from the individual subject as it is conceived in the West. And epistemology, which is in fact a reflection on what is knowable, is not either something that can be understood as it is in the West, the condition of truth for a statement, etc., etc. So every in fact philosophical problem or metaphysical problem, if you wish, that has been posed in the West is being posed in a different manner elsewhere, and you have to go beyond the traditional expression of these to understand them. This is why it's ontological. It's because you cannot say it's sociological, because being sociological would mean that society would explain everything.
Yes.
It's not the case. It's not the case. Society is the product, is a thing to be explained. Mm-hmm. It's not the explanatory factor. Mm-hmm. So this is one. So it's. I'm not the only one engaged in this project, but it implies a complete reformulation of all the concepts we're using, mm-hmm. and in fact of all the intellectual framework with which we understand diversity in the world, human and non-human diversity. Mm-hmm. And this reframing as many consequences, some of them being political. I mean, obviously we cannot go on. The state of the world with global warming, the massive extinction of species, massive pollution, etc., is a result, among other things, but still, of this idea that is, on the one hand, a natural environment, and on the other, in society that use and understand and project their conceptualization of this environment. This idea is partly responsible for the actual situation. It was responsible for very good things also, for the development of sciences, of physics, of chemistry, etc. I'm not a moralist in that sense. No, it is. I differ with I've been discussing this with Jim Engle, for instance, because I think he has a more moral position. No, that we, in a way, the let's say the Western epistemology, to use a vague word, is responsible for a completely immoral and false view of the world, if you wish, no, of false apprehension of the world. I think it's a partial apprehension of any ontology leads to a specific systematization of certain properties of the world. So it's any ontology gives a blueprint for composing certain kinds of worlds. But there are no worlds that are better than others. I mean, they are all partial realization of potentialities, whether it is of qualities, of processes, of relation that obviously exist independently from us. And these partial realizations are legitimate, in that we don't have to we can fight the consequences of as I said, of the Western hubris and of what naturalism has provoked, but it's now as such, it's not more wrong than an animist or an analogist point of view. So in that respect, I think it's the composing world is a good the definition. If I had to give a definition of anthropology, it would be that, you know, the study of the art of composing worlds.
We have a little bit more time, I suppose. I have a few shorter questions, which I would hope we can still get through. Your current research on landscape extends your work on the four ontological modes. So how does the concept of iconic figuration relate to these four ontological modes, and what is its critical value for the anthropology of landscape, and in what directions do you imagine this will take you in the future?
I think one has to distinguish what I'm doing on images and what I'm doing on landscapes.
Okay.
What I'm doing on images is, initially I was interested in looking at what images, when I constructed this framework of four modes of identification in Beyond Nature and Culture, I was using discursive material, even if it's so-called oral literature, but at least they were propositional. And I said, if there is any relevance in what I'm proposing, it might be a good idea to see how it works with images. So I became interested in, apart from a personal interest I have had for many years in the history of art, etc., it would be a good idea to see how it works with images. And this, I began working with images in that respect, so rather as a manner of verifying, ascertaining how these modes of identification worked with images. Mm-hmm. And then progressively I went much beyond that, mm-hmm. and decided to I'm working on that still. I'm writing a book which takes much more time than I thought, because the central argument is that images are iconic agents. No, they are both agents and iconic. In that sense, there's an interesting drift, which, in fact, did not start with Alfred Gell, no, between people who would treat images mainly as having agency and people who treat images as mainly being iconic signs. I think they are both, mm-hmm. and they are both, and so you have to study at the same time how they can be both. And they are not both, they are both because they have agency because they are active in certain circumstances, and also they trigger mechanisms of recognition or agency. In fact, you see their agency, or you infer their agency because of certain triggering devices. And these triggering devices are not the same in the different ontologies, let's say. Mm-hmm. No. So what I'm doing now is studying both how images are good iconic clues of certain ontologies, in the sense that they reveal connections between beings and things that are indicative of a certain way of doing connections in a specific ontology, on the one hand, and at the same time, how there are agents that can be play an active part in the life of humans in certain circumstances, because in each of these ontologies, they are activated by certain devices, formal devices, no, that render them active, and in certain circumstances also, which are specific also to ontologies. So it's a wider panorama. It's why it's taken much more time than I thought to write that book, because. In fact, the amount of material I've been using and the amount of documentation I've been reading is visual material is absolutely huge.
No.
So, and now to turn to landscape. Landscape is another thing. It's going to be obvious in what in the lecture I'm going to give later on today. Mm-hmm. Dissatisfied with the way that landscape has been treated in anthropology or in the social sciences in general, either as a very loose term or a very specific definition of landscape, which is very much based on its genealogy in the West. Mm-hmm. And I think landscape is being used, and in fact. Listening to some of the papers at the conference, mm-hmm. Confirmed this impression, very much like manna was used in anthropology some decades ago. That is, it's a local concept. Landscape is and with different genealogies, whether you consider it with the landscape, landschap. In Dutch, and paesaggio, paisaje, paysage, etc. These are different. There are different genealogies, no. But it's a complex local concept, European concept that is being used as manna. That is for a blanket concept that you can use to describe almost anything. And I don't think it's a good, and it's not a good way to do anthropology, no? To use a concept just to subsume under it almost anything. So this is my interest in landscape, which is also based on personal taste for both landscape painting and walking in nature.
Okay. so this is what transfiguration.
Transfiguration is a way to avoid this choice between either using the concept very loosely or very narrowly. No.
Okay.
So transfiguration is the process. I'm interested in the process rather than in the result. No.
Okay. All right. That sounds like a very interesting book. I'm looking forward to that coming up. I suppose we can have our last question now. Mm-hmm. We can wrap up. What do you consider, this is a slight hop, what do you consider the most significant ways fieldwork has changed since the 1970s when you began to do ethnography? And in what ways has it remained unchanged? And in light of this, how would you advise students starting their research careers today?
I think there's an anecdote which I told once, I think, in a lecture, which was told to me by Mayor Fortes in Cambridge years ago, and it was what Malinowski told him before he went to do fieldwork with Tallency. Malinowski said, as recounted by Fortes, Mayor, you're going to write me a letter after a few weeks saying that it's horrible, everything is, the food is horrible, the climate is horrible, the people are not nice at all, etc., etc. And then you'll write me a series of letters saying that it's getting better, you're getting to work, and you're getting good material, etc., etc. And then at the end of the year, you're going to write me a letter saying that, well, I think it's all right now, I have all the material necessary, I have a few things to make to ascertain, and then I'll come back, and then you'll write me another letter 1 month after that saying I got it all wrong. I have to stay much longer, and this is the standard experience of fieldwork ever since Malinowski. For everyone, and if it's not the case, I don't think it's good fieldwork. There's a very bizarre thing which is often compared to psychoanalysis. No, there's a series of steps wherever the landscape is being the fieldwork is being done. That one has to follow in order to get a grasp of what is going on. And this doesn't change. This is the miracle of ethnography. Ethnography is a method which is, you can say there are differences between anthropology and ethnography, but ethnography is a specific method which has been used by sociologists also now, etc. So what are the changes with respect to that? The main changes are that more and more people tend to study, and I don't think it's a good thing, social settings that are closer to their own upbringings, let's say, which is part of trying to. I mean, you don't do anthropology to resolve identity problems. I think it's not a good thing to resolve your own identity problems. No? Trying to study a place where you've been, where you were born and where you were raised, etc. Might be an interesting reflexive process. I'm not sure it's going to give interesting. You have to have outstanding self-reflexive and critical capacities to do that well.
Yes.
So I don't think it's a very good, but it's a tendency, no? It's a tendency. I don't advocate going to primitive tribes and be thrilled, etc., etc. No, it's not. I think the distance, the cultural, the social, whatever distance is important in the sense that it provides the initial movement towards the being aware of the differences. Mm-hmm. Another dimension which I think is interesting but not very easy to develop is multi-site ethnography, because you have to stay in each of the sites, I think, enough to undergo the kind of progressive understanding which Mayor Fortes was mentioning, and which I think most anthropologists will have the experience of. Mm-hmm. And finally, I think, but that is pleading for my parish in a way, I think that if you are interested in the relationship between humans and non-humans, what is called multi-species ethnography now, requires a very good capacity to study non-humans. So if you are interested in plants, but botany and the physiology of plants, mm-hmm. how plants communicate and things like that. Mm-hmm. If you are interested in animals, ethology, and there are people who are doing that more and more, no? They are not so numerous because it mm-hmm. in fact, it requires acquiring a double training, no? Yeah. And so I have a young colleague now who've been doing that for wolves and herders, for instance, so he's both an ethologist studying wolves and an ethnologist studying herders, and so he can understand how the communities have evolved together in specific circumstances, how this community of wolves is different from other communities of wolves has been studied, he studies comparatively elsewhere. He started his work in Kyrgyzstan and he's made his PhD and then he's been studying a relationship with wolves in Norway and Macedonia, for instance. So it's this is absolutely compulsory if you don't want to sustain the realm of fancy, no? When you talk about animals, you have to study them in depth. At the same time as human, but it's always the relationship, of course. With otherwise you become an ethologist. No, mm-hmm. If you really are interested in doing multi-species ethnography, you have to study how these species, human and non-human, influence each other. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a very, very interesting direction into mm-hmm. which to proceed.
It's challenging, but it's challenging. One of these exciting new directions.
Yes.
All right. I think we can conclude here, unless you wanted to.
No, I think I've probably spoken too long anyway.
Professor Descola, it's been a great pleasure, and it's been an honor. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.